Ghost Town Living is one of my personal favorite YouTube channels. It follows a guy named Brent Underwood as he chronicles the progress of running and rebuilding the abandoned silver mining town of Cerro Gordo, California. The storytelling is always really good, and I highly recommend that anyone check it out. When I first started watching that channel, I thought it would be an amazing opportunity to get down to Cerro Gordo and set them up with solid Wi-Fi coverage for the whole town by designing and implementing a point-to-multipoint network with a wireless backhaul down the mountain. Now, this was well before Starlink was available. We reached out a few times and offered to come out and do this, and I actually did hear back from Brent one time back in December 2020. He asked about our plans to improve connectivity for the town, and I laid out my plan. I told him that we could probably get the equipment donated, our labor would be free to set everything up as long as we could film everything for YouTube. But busy people being busy people, I never heard back, and ultimately I moved on from that project idea, which, by the way, I'd still be more than willing to tackle anytime, Brent, if you happen to be watching this. Then, this past weekend, I saw a new Ghost Town Living video called Installing Wi-Fi 900 Feet Underground in an Abandoned Mine. And that sounds amazing, right? Not exactly the same project that we were thinking of 3 years ago, but certainly a challenge that I would have loved to take on. But since it's already been implemented, I thought it would be fun to do some backseat driving and talk about how they were able to get internet 900 feet down a mineshaft, the equipment that they used, the challenges that they faced, and then talk about what I would have done differently. Sound fun? All right, let's get started. I'll put a full link to the original Ghost Town Living video down in the description if you want to check it out. It starts off with Brent discussing why he needs internet 900 feet down a mineshaft. First, he wants better communication rather than relying on radios and, you know, light signals with flashlights. Taking a 45-minute trip down a rickety mineshaft is a dangerous undertaking, so being able to communicate more effectively with the folks up top is going to be a huge win. Second, the town's water source is at the 700-foot level of the mine, and they've had a bunch of issues with that water source, so he would love a camera down there to keep an eye on what's happening with the water pump. And finally, better infrastructure in terms of power and internet down at the bottom would help them build a solid base camp so that they can then spend more time down there without having to surface as often. So they've got this guy, Brian, who volunteered to set up the network infrastructure, and there are two main pieces. You've got all of the equipment up top installed at the hoist house that receives its connection wirelessly from a tower on the property, and then you've got all the equipment down at the bottom of the mineshaft. So from an equipment perspective, this is a very, very simple network. It's the logistics of taking it 900 feet down into the mine that make it a difficult project. Everything here starts with a nanobeam AC. Now, in the video, they say that the nanobeam AC is picking up its internet connection from a tower that's on the property. Now, back when we were originally designing our point-to-multipoint network for Cerro Gordo, we had actually even gone so far as to contact the owner of that tower to see what it would cost to lease some space. Now, thankfully, it sounds like they've already got that part dialed in. In terms of the wireless backhaul, I have no idea what's actually feeding that tower, and I have no idea what access point is on that tower feeding wireless coverage to the town, but I would hope that the access point covering the town is a point-to-multipoint access point, so that in terms of expandability, you'd be able to just pop up station-side antennas wherever you need wireless coverage in town. Now, since he's picking up that signal with a nanobeam AC, it's pretty safe to assume that whatever access point they do have installed in that tower is also ubiquity. In terms of their internet connection that goes down the mountain, right? If that wireless backhaul is working, then great, I'd say keep it in place. But I would also think about some sort of backup internet connection, namely Starlink. So Starlink is gonna provide 100 to 300 megabits worth of service, and it doesn't have to be tied to the tower that's on the property. It would be a great source of backup internet, or primary internet with the wireless backhaul as the secondary. Now, the downside to Starlink, of course, is the heavier power draw, but it seems that they're on the grid up at Cerro Gordo, so that shouldn't be too much of a problem. So they mounted the NanoBeam AC to the exterior of the hoist house on a pull mount arm. Those pull mount arms are great. They're the same ones that we've used for projects many, many times. It then feeds into a MikroTik Hex PoE light. Now, I have no issue with the MikroTik router. It provides passive PoE for the NanoBeam. It also powers up a mesh access point in the hoist house that you can see in the background of some of the interior shots. People who know and love MikroTik really love MikroTik, right? So I can't fault someone for installing what they know. The one thing that I would maybe do differently is to use something like the UniFi Switch 8 150 watt instead of the MikroTik for a couple of reasons. First, the Switch 8 150 watt can do both 24 volt passive and 802.3 AF and AT PoE for devices that can auto sense their power. Now, I would do that just for future proofing, right? If you wanted to replace the access point in the hoist house or add any other equipment that uses non-passive PoE for power, then you'd have that option. I also like that the Switch 8 150 watt is UniFi and it can be managed by the UniFi cloud. Cerro Gordo is about as remote a location as you can get. And since everything else in the network seems to be Ubiquiti, why not also use Ubiquiti for the switching? Right, I'm sure you can remotely manage the MikroTik as well, but with UniFi, you'd have a single pane of glass for everything. In either case though, I would be sure to leave a spare switch pre-configured just in case the primary switch fails, right? That primary switch is installed into an enclosure in this like dusty hoist house in an environment that is brutally cold in the winter and brutally hot in the summer. It's not exactly the ideal environment for electronics. If you have to replace that switch, you'd be looking at multiple days, if not weeks of downtime to get a replacement. So best to keep a spare on site. All right, so let's now talk about how to get a network feed from up top at the hoist house to 900 feet down the mineshaft. 900 feet is too long for Ethernet, right? So they opted to go with coax using a pair of Veracity high wire one port Ethernet over coax adapters. Now, I've never used these before, but the concept is pretty simple, right? You feed Ethernet with PoE or DC power into the base unit, which then outputs to coax. The coax carries the network along with power through the coax cable all the way down to a receiving unit, which takes coax and power in and then outputs Ethernet with PoE on the other side. Now, these coax Ethernet units can do up to 200 megabits per second, which should be plenty fast for this use case. But I do have a lot of questions about this setup. I mean, first of all, these Ethernet over coax devices are super expensive. The base unit and the remote unit are almost $450 combined. And I get why this may seem like an attractive option since coax can travel much further than Ethernet to get the network where you need it. But here's the thing, right? They ran power down to the bottom of the mineshaft, so you really don't need to push PoE down the coax cable. You can just add a switch with PoE at the bottom and not have to deal with those high wire converters at all. Something like a MoCA adapter can also do the same thing without the PoE for about a third of the price, and you'd get much faster speeds. They also ran into an issue when they first ran coax down the mineshaft. The cable broke at some point, and so they spliced it. When they spliced it, they completely lost both network and power through that coax cable. And it looks like they ended up using a PoE injector at the bottom of the mineshaft anyways. More on that in just a moment. Why coax, right? Why not fiber? Here's where my backseat driving is gonna kick into full gear, right? If they had ditched the MikroTik and instead went with two of the UniFi Switch 8 150 watts, they could have run outdoor rated armored fiber cable down the mineshaft instead. They didn't end up needing power over Ethernet at all, so they wouldn't have had to purchase those Ethernet to coax adapters. Armored fiber does cost a little bit more than coax, but ultimately by ditching those coax adapters, the project budget would have been about, you know, 100 or maybe $200 more overall to eliminate some single points of failure from the network and to install fiber, which is not only faster than what you get with those coax adapters, but it's also not as susceptible to lightning as using copper would be. It just seems that armored fiber would have been a more attractive option, but I'd love to hear what you guys think down in the comments below. As I mentioned earlier, they had broken the coax line and spliced it at some point. So the first attempt to light up the network was a failure. And look, We've all been there, right? You can see the look of absolute disappointment in Brent's face.
Well, first time. Doesn't seem like we're getting any coax all the way down here. Receiver should be lighting up, and I don't think that means somewhere between here and the top, the cable wasn't getting it all the way down here. So, no internet yet. Very sad.
This is a couple minutes of edited video, but in reality, that point in the project was multiple 45-minute trips up and down the mineshaft, installing power, installing coax, and all of the blood, sweat, and tears that come along with a project like this one. It's super disheartening when it doesn't work, but you just gotta pick yourself up and keep going. They did a bit of troubleshooting and figured out that it was, in fact, the coax cable leading down the mineshaft that seemed to be at fault. So he next replaced that 1,000 feet of coax and was finally able to get the remote end of the coax to Ethernet connector connected. But then he ran into another issue. The access point that they had down at the bottom of the mineshaft is the UAP AC Mesh Pro, right? Which is a great access point. We've used dozens of those on installations in the past. But it wasn't connecting, and it appeared to be a power issue. It's possible that the power that was coming off of the coax to Ethernet adapter wasn't sufficient for the Mesh Pro. But then he also tried to power the Mesh Pro with a PoE injector, and it still was not able to broadcast the SSID or connect to the network. So possibly a bad Mesh Pro access point or some other issue that was just preventing that connection from happening. So next, they went all the way back up to the top of the mineshaft and grabbed a UAP AC mesh access point, the non-pro version, which uses less power. Now, I assume they probably just grabbed the one off the wall of the hoist house to try it down at the bottom of the mine. Brent connected up the AC mesh access point, and he was finally able to get a connection down at the bottom. And not a bad connection either, about 50 megabits per second. And then we get to see the excitement and that look of elation that we've all felt when a project actually works.
Finally, mother, you know, we got internet down at 900 level. We got internet down at 900 level. We got, yes!
One of the best feelings, and often makes you forget about the struggles that it took to get there. Here's my unsolicited opinion on the whole project. So first, I would have stuck with a full UniFi infrastructure to keep that single pane of glass for remote configuration and troubleshooting. I would have gone with the US 8 150 watt switches on both ends of the 900 foot link. Now the installer used a MikroTik router, but it looks like he only used it as a switch and he left the WAN port empty. So a switch does seem to be the better choice. Two of the US 8 150 watt switches would give you more switch ports, SFPs for fiber, and they can do both 24 volt passive and 802.3AF ATPoE to give you wider device compatibility. Then you run armored fiber down the shaft and you should get full gigabit connectivity to the bottom. Now, the whole setup is gonna be more expensive, probably a couple $100 more expensive, or more if you wanted to have spares on site, but it gives you more flexibility in the deployment, faster speeds, and fewer points of failure. I also probably would have kept the Mesh Pro access point up at the top in the hoist house and started with the UAP Mesh non-pro access point down at the bottom. I mean, there's no need for extra wireless power down below. You're not gonna be able to do wireless mesh through solid rock. And if you have a switch down there, you can run Ethernet cables to additional access points if you need to. And one other thing that they didn't cover in this video was the camera for that water pump at the 700 level. With what they set up in the video, there's no way to get that camera installed. But if you did have a switch down at the 900 level, you could run Ethernet up 200 feet to the 700 level and get a camera hardwired up there. Or even better, run a cable up to another switch at the 700 level where you could have multiple cameras plus an additional wireless access point if you wanted. But that's just my two cents on this install and an open invitation to Brent and the team at Cerro Gordo. I would be absolutely thrilled to come out and see how we can cover that entire town in Wi-Fi. I still think it would make for an amazing project. All right, what do you guys think? Do you agree with my suggestions, or would you have done something differently? Let me know down in the comments below. And if you'd like to keep this party going, I have hand-selected two videos on the right here for you to watch next. The top video is my recent full review of the new Starlink Gen 3 dish, and the bottom video is the point-to-multipoint wireless network design I did for the coax port in Greece.